All right, welcome back. We're on lecture 11 for this section of Markov chains and infinity. Today we're going to be talking about the Perron-Frobenius theorem. This theorem is going to classify a certain collection of stochastic matrices where we know that the limit as t goes to infinity exists. So certain Markov processes where we know the limit distribution exists. And first, what I'll do, I'll state a weaker version of the theorem just to kind of motivate where we're going in the theorem and just kind of be able to work with some certain examples. And throughout the lecture, I want to actually go through the specific conditions that allow for the limiting distribution to exist. And then in the end, I will state the actual Perron-Frobenius theorem. The theorems for the proofs for the theorems are not going to be given in this lecture. I will postpone this till at least two lectures from now. They're somewhat technical and involved, and for now, we just need the statement. And the statements are fairly straightforward, so we'll continue this way. I will mention that the Perron-Frobenius theorem is not the only way that you can get a limiting distribution. This Perron-Frobenius theorem is going to give us certain conditions that imply a limiting distribution, but it's not an if and only if scenario where the limiting distribution, you need to have the conditions from the theorem. So this is just some conditions that are sufficient, but they're not the necessary conditions. And in the next lecture, we'll actually look at other types of Markov chains that have limiting distribution, but don't satisfy the Perron-Frobenius theorem, but we still have them there, and we'll analyze those Markov chains. And in those cases, it's going to be fairly clear that there has to exist a limiting distribution. And so let's start with some terminology. So as always, we're going to let X of T be a Markov chain with transition matrix P. And we're going to define a matrix P to be positive if all the entries, this is Pij, are greater than zero for every ij. And we denote this as P is greater than zero. So this is a matrix P, and we say that it's greater than zero if each individual entry is greater than zero. And this is actually a definition for any matrix. It doesn't have to be a stochastic matrix or a Markov matrix. It's any matrix. And additionally, we're gonna define a transition matrix P to be regular if there exists some power n greater than or equal to 1, such that P to the n is positive. So meaning that P to the n is P to the n is greater than zero. So all the entries of P to the n are greater than zero. And here I have some simple examples. And in here I'll give you a second to try to decide which one is positive. So we have, or actually this is not what I'm trying to do. What I'm actually trying to show is an example of something that's not positive, but regular. So this is going to be positive. This is not going to be positive. Not positive. And this is because P 2 to 2 is equal to 0. And then in here, we're going to have that P2 is positive, and you can see that all the edges are positive. So we have that this is positive. So that means that P is regular. And this is enough to state a weak version of the Perron-Frobenius theorem. So in here, again, XT is a Markov process with transition matrix P so that P is regular. then there is a limiting distribution pi, so that pi is unique stationary distribution, and that pi, the stationary distribution, is also positive, or each of the entries of pi is greater than zero. And this really means that first, that we're going to have a limiting distribution as time goes to infinity. Whatever distribution we start with, we're going to settle on one final distribution for our states. And each state is going to have positive probability of being there at infinity. So the distribution is going to be greater than zero for each state. And additionally, it says that pi, this limiting distribution, is going to be the unique stationary distribution. Meaning that if you have a distribution that satisfies this condition, this stationary condition, then it has to be the limiting distribution. So in this case, we have that the limiting distribution and then the stationary distributions are the same. We've seen in previous examples that there may be multiple stationary distributions, but if we have this regularity condition, then there's going to be one stationary distribution and one limiting distribution. And in fact, in the previous lecture, we proved that limiting implied stationary, but not necessarily the other way around. But if we do have regularity, then we do have an if and only if statement. And just to recap, in this theorem, we have this condition of regularity, and it's going to imply three different things. That there's a limiting distribution, and that this limiting distribution is the unique stationary distribution, and the probability of each state at infinity is going to be non-zero. So we have three outcomes out of this condition. And as I said earlier, we'll leave the proof for later, but this is going to be our working theorem so that we can start working with this Markov chains. Let's see an example. And it's the same example that I had in the previous two slides. And we considered this regular transition matrix. We saw that p squared is greater than zero, so this is going to be regular. The transition matrix is given by this. And so by the theorem, we know that there exists a unique stationary distribution. So we can just find it by solving the eigenvalue problem. So we just set the eigenvalue problem and writing it explicitly. It means that we have this matrix product is equal to this. And this is going to give us this first two equations. And then the last equation we obtain from the fact that the total probability or the total distribution has to add up to 1. So pi 1 plus pi 2 is equal to 1. So we have this probability constraint and this two equations from the eigenvalue problem. And it's just a system of equations, and we can just solve for it. Pi 1, pi 2 is equal to 2/3 and 1/3. So if we run this Markov matrix for an infinite amount of time, regardless of what initial condition we start with, we're going to end up with this distribution of the two states. And this really means that the probability that the Markov chain at infinity is in state 1 is equal to 2/3, and the probability that the Markov chain is at infinity is at state 2, it's 1/3. And looking now, taking a step back and just trying to interpret this result and looking at the graphical representation, this should make sense that there's a higher probability to be in state 1. And this is because there's more ways to stay in state 1. You can either return back to it or you can arrive from 1, from 2. And this is going to shift more of the probability towards 1. Whereas for 2, once you're here in 2, you're always stepping away. So your probability is kind of going to be going away from it. So it's always good practice to step back, look at the graphical representation, and try to see if the probability distribution that you obtain is consistent with the drawing. And in this case, it's fairly obvious to see. Some other cases, it's less so obvious. But this is a lesson where it actually, sometimes the structure of the graphical representation will hint at the limiting distribution and help you solve this eigenvalue problem. But for now, this is just pretty straightforward to just solve the system of equations. And the last thing, so again, we have three things from the theorem: that there's a stationary distribution, there exists a stationary distribution, and it's also unique, and that the entries are greater than zero. And the last thing is that the limiting distribution exists and it's unique as well. So when I take the limit of this matrix P to a T, as T goes to infinity, I obtain this, where all the rows are equal to the limiting distribution, or the stationary distribution, 2/3, 1/3, 2/3, and 1/3. And here, here I'm not really computing this limit. I'm just saying that this follows by the theorem, that the limit of this matrix has to be equal to this by the statement of the theorem. So if you want, you can think of this as a shortcut for computing limits of matrices, which is kind of the, I think the brute force way, as we've discussed before, is to diagonalize the matrix and have that P of T is equal to U D T U inverse, and take the limit of this and then compute the rest. But in here, we're actually just solving this, and that's it. So this is saving you a lot of trouble. And in the other problem, essentially what you need to do is you need to find all, for if you want to diagonalize, P is equal to U D U inverse. Essentially what you need to do is figure out U and D, which is essentially finding all the eigenvalues for the matrix P, where pi would then make up the entries of your U matrix. But in here, we're just finding one eigenvalue. So it really reduces a problem a lot, knowing that only one eigenvalue is going to survive, and you know which one. And so you can just compute the limit that way. Okay. I hope this is clear. So let's continue. And now that we have this result for the regular matrices, where we know that there's a limiting distribution and a unique stationary distribution, I'm going to spend the rest of the lecture trying to create alternative conditions to the regularity condition so that I can have the same result. And essentially, I'm going to come up with two conditions that imply regularity. And so this is going to be how we're going to have a stronger version of the theorem that we presented in a few slides ago. Because if you think about it, in this example, we had to figure out that P is regular. And in this case, it's not too bad, because we can just compute that P squared is positive. So that was fairly easy. But in certain scenarios, or in certain cases, the matrix could be larger, and it could be that you're in a situation that it takes up to 100 steps for the matrix to be positive. So you would have to keep checking different powers, and you actually need, what we actually want to develop is a condition that will tell us that if something's positive. And in that case, we can then apply the theorem that we've stated. Because potentially you could spend a lot of time trying to figure out if a stochastic matrix is regular. But we want to avoid all that work. And we just want two conditions that are easy to check so that we can check that the matrix is regular, and then we can apply the theorem. The first condition is a communication class. And for the communication class first, I need to introduce some notation, some terminology. So we're going to take a state J, and we're going to say that it's accessible from I if there is a path from I to J. So in here, let me illustrate this with an example. And we say that 3 is accessible from 1 because there's a path. You can actually take a path in the diagram. You go here, and then you go here, and you can reach 3. And on the other hand, 1 is not accessible from 3. If you start from 3, the only way that you can go is 3, and you're staying at 3. So there's no path that will take you to 1. So we have that 1 is not accessible from 3. And this is just the definition of accessibility in layman's term. But mathematically, you say that J is accessible from I if there is some n greater than or equal to 0, such that the transition probability from I to J in n steps is greater than 0. So in this case, we have that P2, 1 to 3, it's going to be, there's one path here, going from here, and then from here, 2 steps, and it's going to be the probability of 1 times 1 half. So this is going to be greater than or equal to 1 half. It's going to be equal to 1 half, but I do the inequality just because there could potentially be other paths that get you there in 2 steps. But in this specific example, I don't think so. But since we found one path with that probability, then that's the lower bound for the probability to get there in 2 steps. So in here, this mathematically, you would write it this way, that there's an n step path from I to J. Is that this transition probability is greater than 0. So this is going to tell us how to, if we can reach one state from the other. And this is the term of accessibility. Now, to make it a bit stronger, we'll say that 2 states I and J communicate if I is accessible from J and J is accessible from I. And the thing to note here is that this is an equivalence relation, meaning that it satisfies these three properties. I is accessible from I. This is a technicality, because if you pay attention here, you have that n has to be greater than or equal to 0. And we have that p to the 0 is equal to the identity, and in the identity, you have the transition from any state I to I is always going to be equal to 1 greater than 0. So we actually, by the way that we define accessibility, we technically made it so that I and I are always accessible. Which makes sense. If you're already an I, then you already reached I. It's already accessible to yourself. So that's good. And it's also symmetric, which it's should be clear from this statement of the definition of the communication class. So you can just switch the roles I and J, and so we have that I, it communicates with J if J communicates with I. So this is just reading the definition backwards. And the last property that we need is transitive. And here I'll give an argument for this in the next slide, but what it says is that if I communicates with J and J communicates with K, then I communicates with K. And it should not be too hard to believe. But the punchline in all this is that communication classes are an equivalence relations, meaning an equivalence relation, meaning that the set of vertices, or vertices, or equivalently, the states of the set of states of your Markov chain can be partitioned into different sets, which are communication classes. And each CL corresponds to all the states that communicate with each other. So it's a set of the maximal set of elements that commute with each other for each set. So we can partition our states this way by communication classes. So let's look at an example. Again, our working example for this lecture is this Markov matrix. We already know that one doesn't communicate with three, so one and three are not going to be in the same communication class. And you can tell by the graph pretty clearly that one communicates with two. So we'll see that this Markov chain has two communication classes, one and two, and three. So these are going to be our two communication classes. And we're going to have this two communication classes, and let's see the proof for transitivity. And this is pretty straightforward proof. It's just following the definition and just noting that we have that if I communicates with J, then has to be a non-zero path from I to J, say in N1 steps. And if J communicates with K, then there has to be a non-trivial path from J to K in, say, N2 steps. This is for some N1 greater than or equal to 0, and this is for some N2 greater than or equal to 0. Then my claim is that if there's a path from I to J in N1 steps, and there's a path from J to K in N2 steps, then we can just concatenate those paths. So I'm going to have I, J, K, N1, N2. So I have a path from I to J in N1 plus N2. And I can write this formally, or more precisely as follows. My claim is that there's going to be a path from in N1 plus N2 steps from I to K. So I have to show that this is positive. And I use matrix multiplication, meaning that I have that P to the N1 plus N2 is going to be the matrix product of P N1 times P N2. And the matrix multiplication is just given by this. And since all these entries are positive, then I can do a lower bound. This is greater than or equal to. I can do a lower bound by just restricting the summation to the case when m equals to j. So this is going to be this case. So I pick one particular element in the summation, which is the element where m is equal to j. And this is going to be that term. And we know from the communication condition of I and J and J and K that this is greater than zero and this is greater than zero. So that means that the product is greater than zero. So we have that there is a path from I to K in N1 plus N2 steps. And then we have that I is accessible or K is accessible from I. We still need to show that I is accessible from K, but you just reverse the rules of I and K. and we obtain the same conclusion. And so we have that this communication relation is transitive. And graphically, I just think about it this way. So there's got to be a path from I to J, and it wants steps, and J to K, there's a path, and then two steps, so there's going to be a path, P, and 1 plus N2. So that's fairly clear. All right, so the definition coming out of this communication classes is that we're going to say that a Markov chain is irreducible. Well, irreducible if it only has one communication class. So from each state, you can reach any other state in some amount of steps. And for now, let me just state the following result, which is useful in computations and some of the problems in the textbook, and we'll prove it later. And we're going to assume that pi is the stationary distribution for an irreducible Markov chain. And we're going to introduce the random variable t sub j, which is the time to reach state j. So it's the minimum number of steps greater than 0, so that x sub n is equal to j. And the result here is that the expected number of steps, tj, given that you start in state j, is going to be 1 over pi j. And we'll postpone this proof till later, but this is consistent with an earlier result that we had before, which was an interpretation of the stationary distribution. And it's here. So in here, this is for a stationary, actually this is for a limiting distribution. So if in the case that limiting distributions and stationary distributions are equal to each other, then this is the result that I just showed is going to be consistent. So in here, we show that the proportion of time spent in state J is going to be given by this random variable, and that the expected value of the proportion of time spent there is going to be equal to lambda j. So if we have that the proportion of time spent in state j is equal to lambda j, or pi j if it's the stationary distribution, then the time to come back to the same position should be 1 over pi j. So the proportion, if you spend on average 1 over pi j My claim is that 1 over lambda j is the time to return to j. And this is the heuristic argument, or how these two things are consistent. And you should try to convince yourself about this statement. And maybe the simplest way to, some simple examples to consider are, for instance, this simplest non-trivial case, one and one, the stationary and the limiting distribution of this is going to be 1/2 and 1/2. And in here, the interpretation is that 1/2 is the proportion of time spent in state one. And if you take 1/π, component wise, it's going to be 2 and 2. So this is going to be telling us that the expected amount of time to return to state one is 2 steps, 1 and 2. Everything's deterministic here, so the expected values are deterministic, or the random variables are deterministic. So in here, you can see in this example how if you take the inverse of the stationary distribution, it's going to tell you the expected number of steps to return to the same state. So this these two statements are consistent, and you should think about it. This is a remark. But again, I'll leave, this is a heuristic argument or a way to think about it and what we've seen recently. And so we'll prove this in a later lecture. But for now, you can just use this result. Now, we're moving on to the second condition that we need for the for regularity, and this is called periodicity. And the prototypical example is going to be the example that we just looked at. It's going to be this two-state chain where we deterministically change states each step. And here you note that after 2 steps, you return to intuitively you after 2 steps you always return to the same state, so intuitively we have that the period is 2. And but we actually have to give a more precise definition of this period, and it's going to be state dependent, this condition of periodicity. So more precisely, we're going to define the period of the state as follows. And then di, which is the period of state I, be the greatest common denominator of the set of steps greater than or equal to 1, such that the transition probability of I to I in n steps is greater than 0. So let's look at, actually, I'm going straight to the proof to have a claim, but in here, I'll consider this set n greater than or equal to 1, such that p n 1 1 is greater than 0. And in this case, you can check that this is going to be 2, 4, 6, 8, and it's the times that you return to the same state after n steps. So in here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. So this is going to be that set, and we need to find the greatest common denominator of all of these, and it's clear that the greatest common denominator is equal to 2. So this means that d of 1 is equal to 2. And you can check and do the same computation and see that the period of 2 is 2. So that's why in this prototypical example, we just say the period is 2, and because they both have the same period. And it turns out that, in fact, if two states, I and J, are in the same communication class, then these two states are going to have the same period. Di. Dj. So Let's prove this. So it's gonna be, I'm gonna create some paths, and in here, let's jump to the end and see where we're heading. And here, what I want to show is that first, I don't assume that they're equal to each other, but what I want to show is that dj divides di. And the argument that I'm going to be giving is going to be symmetric, so in the states I and j. So we're also going to have that by the same argument, if you reverse the rules of I and j, we're going to have that di divides dj. So we're going to have this, and yeah, switching the rules of ij, we're going to have that di divides dj. So that means that di has to equal to dj, since they're both positive. It could be that di equals minus dj, but that's not good. They're both positive quantities, so they're equal to each other. So this is what I'm trying to do. This is my goal, to show that dj divides di. And the way that I go about it is by writing for, so in here, for every path NL in RJ, so RJ is going to be the set of steps that return you to the same state J. So in here, NL is going to be a path from J to J. And for every NL, I can write a path from I to I. And the way that I do it, since I and J are communicated, I have a path going to from I to J and J to I, which I or say K1 steps and K2 steps. So for every path that returns to J, I can write a path that returns to I. So I can take K1 steps to J, NL steps, and K2 steps. So I can create a path from I to I. And in here, this is going to create a path N tilde L with steps K1, NL plus K2. And RI is this the number of paths or the set of return times for element I. And I'm going to have that this is going to be a return time or return number of steps for every NL in RJ. And similarly, I can do the same thing for any N tilde L. I can write N tilde L in RI, any return time NL, I can write a path that returns to J. So I can go K2, N tilde L, and K1. And that's going to give me a path in RJ, which I call NL prime. And this is going to be, the number of steps is going to be K2 plus N tilde L plus K1. And in here, just by substituting this and this, this in here, I have that N L prime is equal to 2K plus 2K, K1 plus K2 plus NL. And this is going to tell me that DJ really tells me that DJ divides 2, this quantity. But in actually in this construction, you can actually see that this number of times that I go back and forth, I can multiply it times any integer. I can do it r times. R, 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 r. And when I do the substitution here, substitute this in here, then I'm going to have r. So I have that this divides r for every 2r. For every r, greater than or equal to 1. So my conclusion was that it divides just k1 plus k2. But actually, I thought I had this 2 missing. Anyways, so for now, let's just assume that it divides k1 plus k2. And now we have that dj divides k1 plus k2. And so that means that when we write actually, this is something that all right, so this is, let me reintroduce the R's. This is for R, 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 R. This is going to be 2R. This is going to be 2R. And this is for every R greater than or equal to 1. And then we have that N. So this is N tilde L. This is going to be, let me write this. Minus k1 plus k2. And we can actually switch. And since it's for every r, so I'm actually taking this equation right here. And this is for every r, so I can just write this as, I can say r tilde, and I can write this as 2r. So this dj divides this. This divides this part, and I have that dj, which is n prime in rj. That dj divides this and this term, so it divides every n tilde l. So, because I'm actually taking this equation, and this says that for every n tilde l, I can write it this way, for some n prime l, nl prime, for nl prime, and where we have this error term or this loop term, which is going to be a 2r. And we've shown that by the definition of dj, we know that dj divides nl prime. And we've shown that dj divides this quantity right here. And so we know that for every n tilde l, dj divides this number. So that means that dj has to divide di. And we can switch the roles of I and j, and we can have that di divides dj. So the result is that di has to equal to dj. So here the proof says that if I and j communicate, then their periodicity is going to be the same, which it's consistent with this example right here that we saw. So let's consider a following example. And here, let's look at the set of paths that, or the number, or the return times for state one. So in here, this is going to be the set, and you can return in two paths. Or you can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, or you can go 1, 2, 3, 4, wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right. This is good because I actually computed it wrong last time. I thought it was 6. So let's get this straight. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It is 6. So 6, and then 8. You can do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And these are going to be the return times, and meaning that the period of state 1 is going to be 2. And you can convince yourself that these are all in the same communication class, and these two are in the same communication class. And for R5, you can check that. The return times for 5 is going to be 1, 2, or 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's going to be this. And here, the period of this communication class is going to be 1. So this is a simple example to figure out the periods of the Markov chain. Now, we come to the Perron-Frobenius theorem, and it's a similar statement as the first theorem that we stated. We have XT, a Markov process with transition matrix P. In theta of regular, we have the conditions irreducible and aperiodic. And if we have those conditions, then we have the three conclusions: that there's a limiting distribution, it's a unique stationary distribution, and the distribution is positive. So the probability of each state is positive. And in particular, that means that there exists a limiting distribution with all the entries greater than zero, and there's a unique solution to this eigenvalue problem. So essentially, we've replaced the regularity condition with this irreducible and aperiodic condition. And I say that this is a stronger theorem because checking irreducibility and aperiodicity is something you can just check by looking at the diagram of the Markov chain. And you don't have to take powers of the transition matrix to figure that out. And this is much simpler to do than checking regularity in general. So this will, in fact, if you have these two conditions, it will imply regularity, and then you have the same result. One remark though, and let's go back to our original example. This example, you'll see that we've established that this Markov matrix or this Markov chain has a limiting distribution, is regular, so the first theorem applies. But here, we don't, wait, is this, let me double check. Oh, no, never mind. Never mind, I thought we'd shown that there's a limiting distribution for this. But never mind. No. Yeah. So this is an example where it's not irreducible, so the theorem doesn't apply. And you'll see that the limiting distribution of this, there exists a limiting distribution, but you'll see that in this case, and this is what we're going to talk in the next lecture. In this case, there will be a limiting distribution, but one of the results of the theorem is not going to hold. And that's what we'll see in the next lecture. This is not going to hold anymore. Anyway, that's it for this lecture. Next lecture, we're going to talk about absorbing chains, other types of chains that have limiting distributions, but whose condition, this condition is not satisfied, and meaning that the probability is absorbed away from the states where the probability I is equal to zero. So these are going to be absorbing chains, and we'll look at them and look at related questions regarding them. All right.